What is calculus? This isn't something we inherited from the ancient Greeks, like geometry. This subject was discovered much more recently, in the late 1600s, by Isaac Newton and Gottfried Leibniz. They didn't work together, they both discovered calculus on their own, and as a result, there was a huge argument over who should receive credit for its discovery. But we're going to save that story for another video. Today, let's talk about what they discovered. In calculus, you start with two big questions about functions. First, how steep is a function at a point? Second, what is the area underneath the graph over some region? The first question is answered using a tool called the derivative. And to answer the second question, we use integrals. Let's take a look at the derivative, the tool that tells us how steep a function is at a point. Another way to think about the derivative is it measures the rate of change of a function at a point. As an example, let's use the function f of x equals x cubed minus x squared minus 4x plus 4. Suppose we want to find the steepness of the graph at the point negative 1, 6. How would we do it? And what do we even mean by steepness? In algebra, you find the rate of change of a line by computing the slope, the change in y divided by the change in x. But this is a curve, not a line. So we get a good look. Let's zoom in a bit. Here's the idea. Pick a second point nearby. How about the point negative 0.8, 6.048? Next, draw a line through these two points. The slope of this line is a good approximation for the steepness of the curve at the point negative 1, 6. If you compute the slope, you get 0.24. This is a good approximation, but we can do better. What if we pick a different point that's even closer? How about negative 0.9, 6.061? If you compute the slope of the line through this point and negative 1, 6, you get 0.61. If you keep picking closer and closer points and computing the slopes of the lines, you'll get a sequence of slopes, which are getting closer and closer to some number. The lines are getting closer and closer to the tangent line, and the slopes are approaching 1. So we say the slope of the curve at the point negative 1, 6 is 1. We call this number the derivative of f of x at the point where x equals negative 1. This is the slope of the tangent line through the point negative 1, 6. Luckily, you won't have to do this every time you want to measure the rate of change at a point. In calculus, you'll learn how to find a function which will give you the slope of any tangent line to the graph. This function is also called the derivative. Next, let's take a look at the integral. This is the tool that lets you find areas under curves. As an example, let's look at the function g of x equals sine x. What if we wanted to find the area under this curve between x equals 0 and x equals pi? How would we do it? We know how to find the area of simple shapes like rectangles and circles, but this is much more curvy and complicated. Let's zoom in to get a closer look. Here's the idea. Slice the region into a bunch of very thin sections. Let's start with 10 slices. For each section, find the area of the tallest rectangle you can fit inside. There are 10 thin rectangles. The width of each rectangle is pi over 10, and we can find the height using the function g of x. Next, add up the areas of all 10 rectangles. We get a combined area of 1.66936. This is a pretty good approximation to the area under the curve, but we can do better. What if we do this again but use 25 slices instead? This time, we get an approximate area of 1.87195. Let's do this again and again using thinner and thinner slices. 50 slices, 100 slices, 1,000 slices. You get a sequence of areas that are getting closer and closer to some number. It looks like the area is approaching 2. We call this area the integral of g of x from x equals 0 to x equals pi. So we have these two tools, the derivative and the integral. The derivative tells us about a function at a specific point, while the integral combines the values of the function over a range of numbers. But notice there is something similar to how we found the derivative and the integral. In the case of the derivative, we found two points that were close to each other. Then we let one point get closer and closer and closer to the point that we're interested in. In the case of the integral, we took the curve and we chopped it up into a bunch of rectangles to approximate the area under the curve. Then we took thinner and thinner rectangles to get better and better approximations. In both cases, we're using the same technique. In the case of the derivative, we're letting the points get closer to each other. In the case of the integral, we're letting the rectangles get thinner. In both instances, we're getting better and better approximations, and we're looking at what number these approximations are approaching. The number they're approaching is called the limit. And because limits are key to computing both the derivative and the integral, when you learn calculus, you usually start by learning about limits. A lot of your time in calculus will be spent computing derivatives and integrals. You'll start with the essential functions, polynomials, trig functions, sine, cosine, and tangent, exponential functions, and logarithmic functions. These are the building blocks for most of the functions you'll work with. Next, you'll make more complex functions by adding, subtracting, multiplying, and dividing these functions together. You'll even combine them using function composition. In calculus, there are a lot of rules to help you find derivatives and integrals of these more complex functions. The derivative rules have names like the product rule, quotient rule, and chain rule. The integral rules include U substitution, integration by parts, and partial fraction decomposition. When you first start calculus, your focus will be on basic functions, functions with one input and one output. But we don't live in a one-dimensional world. Our universe is much more complicated. So once you've mastered calculus for basic functions, you'll then move up to higher dimensions. For example, consider a function with two inputs and one output, like f of x, y equals e to the negative x squared plus y squared. Earlier, we computed the derivative by computing slopes of tangent lines, but in higher dimensions, things are a bit more complex. This is because on a surface, instead of a tangent line, you'll have a tangent plane. To handle this, you'll compute the derivative both in the x direction and in the y direction. We call these partial derivatives. These two partial derivatives are what you need to describe the tangent plane. We'll also need to generalize the integral. The region below a surface is three-dimensional. It has a volume, not an area. To compute the volume, we'll approximate it using a bunch of skinny boxes. To sum up all the volumes, you'll need to use a double integral, because the boxes are spread out in two dimensions. But don't forget we live in three spatial dimensions, so you'll also need to learn calculus for functions with three inputs, x, y, and z. If a function has three inputs and one output, we call it a scalar field. An example would be a function returning the temperature at a given point in space. And the outputs of functions don't have to be simply numbers, they can also be vectors. A function with three inputs and a vector output are called vector fields. An example would be a function which gives the force vector due to gravity at every point in space. To recap, the two main tools you'll learn about in calculus are the derivative and the integral. The derivative tells you about a function at a specific point. Namely, it tells you how quickly the function is changing at that point. The integral combines the values of a function over a region. You'll start your study of calculus by learning how to compute the derivatives and integrals of a wide variety of functions. Next, you're going to take these tools and apply them to higher dimensions by using things called partial derivatives and multiple integrals. And along the way, you'll learn how to apply derivatives and integrals to solve real-world problems. So now that you've seen the big picture, it's time to start learning the details. So let's get to work. We'll be releasing many more calculus videos soon. The best way to find out when we release a new video is to text a friend each morning and ask if Socratica has published a new video. And if you would like to help us grow and release videos more quickly, please consider supporting us on Patreon.